Reese. Comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 28, starting at verse 16. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." The Gospel of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. You may be seated. See a sign that looks like that, usually it's red and says stop. But in this case, it's really about go. We're going to talk today about a divine command for Christian service. Last week's message, if you didn't catch it, you can go on the blog site or on the YouTube channel and you can get that. We talked about the marks of a disciple, what it means and what we see from someone who is a disciple of Jesus Christ. But in a big part of this, it is understanding the command that God gives us. And what does divine mean anyway? Divine has to do with God. Yeah, in the dictionary it says of, from, or like God. But let's go a little bit deeper than that. Biblically, when you define the word divine, we're talking about something that is holy, something that is eternal. And if you go deeper into the study of the language, you look at the Greek, the word divine and its origin comes back to theos, which means God. So when you think and you hear the word of theology, it is the study of God. So for something to be divine, that means it is of God and it comes from God. So when you hear a divine command, that this is something that is from God, and the characteristics of the command is about God. And for a Christian, for a Christ follower, those commands that come from God need to be followed. Let's think about that. A divine command, a command that is going to come from God, requires our obedience. So as we talk today, we're going to talk a little bit about what we read there in the Gospel. We're going to tie a little bit back to Deuteronomy, to Israel, to understand that God's command, God's call on our life, just as much importance and significance as just as Jesus was sitting there with his disciples. So let's prepare ourselves, our hearts and our minds. Let's pray together. Oh God, open my heart and my mind.
Open my heart and my mind.
So I can hear your word.
So I can hear your word.
And know your will for my life.
And
then give me the courage,
to
go from this place. You know, last week we wrote down four key things about disciples. I just want to hit those real quick. The first thing we said is a disciple is submissive to God's will. You are submissive to God's will. God's will takes priority over anything that you have in your heart or in your mind. A disciple is obedient to his commands. That when the command is given, he is obedient, she is obedient to follow. We are responsive to God's love. And oftentimes we see that in worship and praise. We understand the love that God has shown us and we respond to that love. And we also seek fellowship with other people of God. When we look at the commands that God gives, we can go back to Israel. Go all the way back to God's chosen people. There's a reason that they were chosen. It wasn't because they were somehow special. They were made special because God chose them. You see the difference? It's not that they had done anything that made them, you know, separate from everybody else. God chose them specifically. Their significance of the Old Testament, their story, is important because God made it important. And so when we go to the story, Observe them carefully, talking about the statutes and laws, for this will show your wisdom and understanding to the nations, who will hear about all these decrees and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. What other nation is so great as to have their gods near them the way the Lord our God is near us whenever we pray to him? And what other nation is so great as to have such righteous decrees and laws as this body of laws I'm setting before you today? You see, Israel, early on, one of the commands, one of the things about being set apart, is that they would show the rest of the nation who God was. Their existence and their being set apart was to bring glory to God. And how were they to do that? By following the decrees, by following the commands that God had given them. He said, I am going to bless you. I am going to multiply you. I am going to take care of you. They were to become the light of the world. Israel was to be that light, so that all the other nations, all the other peoples, could see what God was doing in their life. How God was protecting them. How God was guiding them. Now let's also understand the fact that the Israelites always respond to that the right way? Did they always follow what God had asked them to do? Well, no. That's why we have the Old Testament. You talk about Jesus having patient with God. Amazing. But that doesn't mean that Israel did not face the judgment. So what do you mean? God's always loving. God's always good. Yeah, you know what? Everything that we do is going to be judged. Everything that we do, everything that we have done, everything we're currently doing, everything we will do, will be judged. Did Israel get scattered? Yes. Why? Because they were not faithful to what God was calling them to do. But God never left them. He restored them. He worked through them. The point is when God calls us and God commands us, and he tells us that we need to do things, we are serving a purpose in glorifying him. Israel in the Old Testament is just as important to us as Jesus in the New Testament. Because it's all a part of God's story. The people back then that were called by God to be an example to the world. And then Jesus comes to us. And he brings the role model that we are to follow. And he is the one who is going to give us salvation. It's our faith in Jesus that brings us that. In the gospel reading, he is talking to the disciples. And this is known as the Great Commission. I want you to think for a second, let's take a little break, and think about what the disciples had just been through in those weeks and those months. The disciples are called to gather to meet Jesus in Galilee. In the near past, they recognized Jesus as Messiah. They celebrated that. They came to Jerusalem, saw him arrested, beaten, crucified, buried, and then resurrected to go from the pit at the bottom to the tremendous joy of Jesus is back with us, and here he is, and he's doing miracles, and he's talking to us, and he's showing us the way, and now he's calling us, and he's going to go away again. This line here, I want to clarify. When they saw him, to Jesus called them to this place. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Notice the language. They worshipped him, some doubted. Well, what does doubt mean to us? Does doubt mean that we disagree? Does doubt mean the negative? The actual meaning of doubt is uncertainty. So think about what the disciples were feeling. Here Jesus has been telling us things, he's preparing us for things, and we're here worshiping him. We recognize he is the Messiah. The doubt is the uncertainty of the future. You see that? They all worshiped him. But the doubt that lingered in the disciples was, how are we going to do this going forward? How are we going to take care of ourselves if you are not here? I'm sure that that is something that all of us can relate to in some form or another, isn't it? At some point in our life, someone who had taken care of things for us no longer was doing that. And that can be a scary proposition. You see, the disciples were uncertain. They were hesitant about the future. That's the key thing. The doubt does not indicate that they did not believe he was God, that they did not believe he was the Messiah. The doubt was in themselves about what the future was going to hold. And that brings us to what Jesus' words are. So we're going to try to understand Jesus' words in the Great Commission. The first thing you have to understand is Jesus makes a proclamation. So what's a proclamation? A proclamation is an official announcement. We are making something that is official, and this is the way it's going to be. And what is it that Jesus is proclaiming? All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. That's a proclamation. It's a statement. Here it is. It's official. I am telling you, the disciples, all authority is given to me. Everything in heaven and on earth. Isn't that truly amazing? Think about what that really entails. All authority, all things, not a little department. He's not over the food section. Over everything. Everything that we can see and everything that we cannot see, it is his authority. And it is given to him by God. Who has authority in your life? It's an interesting question. Who has the authority in your life? What is it that you bow down to? What is it that trumps all your decision making? Is it God? Is it God all the time? Or sometimes we forget. Sometimes we work to please other people and forget that our audience we're trying to please is really just one. Has anybody here ever tried to impress somebody? Every guy in the room should raise their hand at this point. But when we talk about truly believe that we know has our best interests at hand, we know will take care of us and has control. And there is no person on earth that can match the authority of Jesus. Not one. Let's go to the second part, the command. Now hold on to your hats, folks. Because some of you are going to get uncomfortable. Jesus is giving a command to the disciples. And what does that command say? Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. Now let's make a point here about command, right? A command is not an option. A command is not a suggestion. Jesus did not look at them and say, hey, I'd really like to see you go out and talk to some other people about me. This was a command. And a command is an order. Jesus is giving a command to the disciples. They need to go. Well, what does go mean? What does go mean? It means action, doesn't it? It means you're going to go someplace. It means you're not going to just sit here and feel good about yourself and what you know in Jesus, but you are to go. And when you do, what are you supposed to do? You're supposed to make disciples. Holy cow, what does that mean? What does that entail? In making disciples, you have to teach people about who Jesus is. You have to teach them about the nature of Jesus, about the love that Jesus has, the actions of what Jesus did. And you want to know the easiest thing to do? It's the easiest and the hardest, I guess. When you're talking to people who do not know Jesus, or who have questions, who aren't sure, they're trying to be on the fence, and, Jesus sounds like a good idea, but I don't know. When you're talking to those people, you know what they really want to hear? I mean, you could throw scripture at them all day long. You can pull out the Bible and say, hey, look, this says it. But you know what they really want? They want to know how Jesus has made a difference in your life. If you have this living God, and this living God loves you, what's he done in your life? Do you have your Jesus story? Do you have that story of where Jesus turned your life around? Where Jesus carried you when you couldn't go any further? See, that makes it relatable to people. It's your story. And how your story is a part of God's bigger story. So baptizing, wow, what does that mean? We're to go out not only to make disciples, but then to baptize them. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We talked about baptism a month or so ago. It is the outward sign of inward transformation. It is a means of grace for God to help transform their lives. Does baptizing just mean all of a sudden, ooh, everything's good and I'm clean and I don't have to do anything anymore? No. But baptism is that welcoming in to Christ's family. It is the opportunity for God to work in the lives of that person. Jesus himself was baptized to fulfill the scripture. And so Jesus calls on us to baptize as well. But did you notice the order there? We're not to go baptize and then make disciples. We're to go teach and make disciples and then baptize. And in the early church, if you were going to get baptized, you might spend an entire year studying and preparing yourself so that you understood what was being asked of you and who God was, so that truly in your heart you can be accepted. So that you truly accept who Christ is as being the Word of your life. And then the very last part, the teaching. See, once the baptism happens, you never stop learning. I'm sorry, Bob, you never stop learning. It just keeps coming. We're always going to be taught new things. God always has something for us. As long as you are here, God has purpose for you here. Amen?
Amen.
Without question. Still some spiritual gifts. You have them in one season, but not another. But God always has a purpose for you. He wants to love you. He wants to grow you. He wants to develop that relationship. Teaching process should never stop. Who are you coming alongside in your life right now to mentor, to help in their journey with Christ? That's a challenging question. Do you have someone in your life that you look at that you know needs love, needs a little bit more of the teaching and the support? Important to have people in your life that you are looking out for, that you are trying to help in their faith world. So, in Jesus' words, we have a proclamation, we have a command. But now I'm going to tell you what, does anyone feel intimidated by this command? Raise your hand. Anybody? Does that feel intimidating? But here's the solace. Well, what is the solace, you say? He says, all authority in heaven. Surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. So what is the solace? It is comfort and consolation. It is intimidating to think that that's what we're being called to. We think that that's just for the disciples. But the comfort that we get is that God is always with us. He is never going to abandon us as we are moving as he's calling. He's never going to walk away from us. We still might make mistakes. We still might fall short. He is there to help bridge that gap. You continue to walk faithfully with him. He will always be there to support you. If you let him, he'll give you the words. If you let him, he'll give you the time to be quiet and to this is what the disciples, you know, he understood how they were feeling. He understood the apprehension, the uncertainty that how are we going to do this on our own? But I'll point out to you in the Gospel of John, it has Jesus' word saying, if I do not go, then you cannot have the Advocate. The Holy Spirit will come and will be with you and will be on you and will guide your words and he will take care of you. That is the promise. That's why God is always with us. You see, brothers and sisters, we can take great comfort that whatever that command is, whatever we are called to do, we do not have to do it on our own. God will always be there. Let me give you another step. God will put people in your life to help you on that journey. Whatever season, whatever time it is, God will bring somebody and help you along that way. Yeah, that solace is important. Remember, we are never alone when we faithfully follow Jesus. Again, we are never alone when we faithfully follow Jesus. Jesus' words to us in the Great Commission, the proclamation of his authority, is the command for you to follow. Take it seriously. Share that message of Christ's love with others. So I want to pray, but I want to start first as I read into this prayer, Psalm 119, verse 165. In my devotions this week, this scripture came up, and I'm going to read through verse 168 as we go into prayer. Great peace have those who love your law, and nothing can make them stumble. I wait for your salvation, Lord, and I follow your commands. I obey your statutes, for I love them greatly. I obey your precepts and your statutes, for all my ways are known to you. Heavenly Father, you know who we are. You know our hearts. You know our fears and our concerns. You know our stumbling. God, we give you thanks for the grace and mercy that you pour out to us. That you should come to us, lift us up, love us, and to support us. Lord God, let us turn our love to you. Let us turn our attention to you and to the commands that you've given us. Help us to recognize, Lord, that you are your laws are for our protection and for our freedom, that we may live into the joy that you have promised us. Lord, we pray that you strengthen us this week as we leave this place. Help us to go with purpose, to share the good news of what you have done in our life, to help mentor those who need to see your love. Continue growing, continue.